Hey everybody, hope everybody's doing well. This is a get-together type of meeting, something the Board of Selectmen, have tried before, but I don't think we're successful. I think this is the first time, I think there was, 38 or 78 boards and committees within the community here, and I figured at least 80 people would show up, but this is fine. So I want to make sure we're all on the same page, that we're all talking the same stuff, that we all understand between each other what each goals and what our goals are in each community, committee or board that you belong to, and what the Board of Selectmen's goals are for the future as well. So I'd like to start by introducing myself, and then if we can just go around the room and everybody can introduce themselves, kind of like an AA meeting, but no alcohol, okay? All right, I'm John Kaplis. I'm on the Board of Selectmen. I just got voted in May, so I'm kind of new at this.
Doug Borson, also a member of the Board of Selectmen, Capital Planning Committee, as well as Senior Center Oversight Committee.
I'm Dennis O'Brien, the Board of Appeals.
Mike Morgan, Library Trustee, and several other committees on the side.
John Columbus, Selectman.
Rick Moulton, Zoning Board of Appeals.
Dave Steinman, just a volunteer on Conservation.
Roy Andrews, Chairman of Conservation, and on the Community Preservation.
Debbie Fosher, School Committee.
Mickey Kirby, Cemetery and Parks.
Paul Sayre, Chairman, Cemetery Commissioners.
And the Mayor, Superintendent of the Cemetery and Parks and Historical Commission.
I am Morrison. I'm the Director of the Council on Aging. I'm an ex officio member of the Senior Center Oversight Committee, and I'm also a member, ex officio, I guess, of the Council on Aging Board.
Priscilla Orpler, I'm the Chairman of the Council on Aging, and I'm also on the Site Committee.
Diane Haley Brooks, Select Woman. I'm on the, School Budget Committee. I don't even know how many other ones, so that's where I'm at.
Julie Richards, Selectman.
Dave Smart, I'm one of the Templeton Highway Workers. I'm on the Insurance Advisory Committee and also the Zoning Board of Appeals.
I'm Carter Caranzini. I'm the Interim Town Administrator, bridging the gap until March 1, and the hire of your new permanent Town Administrator.
Mike Bennett, Chief of Police.
Ron Gavin, Water Superintendent, and I'm on the ZBA.
Kate Fulton, Advisory Board, and also the Budget Subcommittee for the School District.
Paul Grubb, Advisory Committee.
Oprah Spring, Advisory Committee.
Gordon Moore, on the Advisory Committee.
Beverly Bartolomeo, Advisory Committee.
Julie Farrell, Advisory Committee.
John Buckley, Planning Board.
Dennis Rich, Planning Board, CPA, and Open Space Committee.
I'm Steve Castle, Cable TV Advisory Committee, and also on the Scout Hall Committee with Julie and John, and the Economic Development Committee with John and Glenn Eaton back there.
Earl Baxter, Conservation Committee.
Luke Roddy, Board of Health.
Tim Roddy, Planning Board.
And back to me. So do you understand why we're here? Does anybody have any idea why we're here?
No.
We don't have any idea, right?
This is not an AA meeting?
Well, it's not an AA meeting, no. That'd be very bad for us. We have one commonality in this community. One. You know what that is? The town itself. We're all doing stuff for the flag, for the town. Are you guys getting paid?
No.
I know I'm not getting paid. Do you get paid, Doug?
No.
No, we don't get paid. So obviously we're doing something for the benefit of the community and the good of the community, right? So how do we get to where we are today with communication? That was my agenda. My computer's not working well. So I had a nice little agenda. So communication was key. Being in the service for a long time, I realized the single point of failure in anything that we do is communication. It doesn't matter what it is. It's Parks and Recreation or Cemetery Commission, or if it's Health and Services or Council on Aging, it doesn't matter. If you don't communicate effectively with everybody around you, so everybody knows, at least has an idea of what's going on for the future, then it's going to fail because there's no support there. So we all have to kind of support each other. And this is open forum, so this is like a free talk session, so please, I don't want to talk all night. Does everybody agree with that, or? Laura nodded heads. Al, what have you got going on for the cemeteries? As far as the grants and stuff, right? You have a lot of stuff going on?
I do. I have the tomb restoration going on right now, where it's just about ready to go out to bid. I am searching for grants for the future. Just got through doing the grant for the Templeton Center Playground, as well as taking care of all the cemeteries and the packs.
That's pretty good. It's a pretty big show. Diane, you got a lot of stuff going on over there. I see that newsletter every month. You kidding me? That thing's packed solid. Does everybody get the newsletter from the Council on Aging?
Yes.
It's a pretty decent newsletter, right? So there's a lot of stuff going on in town. That's a great way to put some resources out there so everybody knows what's happening with pretty much a lot of the different groups. Veteran Services, to include Veteran Services, as well as other Lions Club information, or et cetera, any of the women's clubs. There's a lot of information that's been out there. That's a good resource. It's been always a good resource. So what else do you guys do for like communication? Wes, Crickets in here. Yeah. Advisory committee, how do you communicate effectively with the Board of Selectmen?
Not very well, because the chairman and I have talked to him a number of times and he never calls me back.
Might be the tone.
No, but my phone doesn't work. I'm just kidding. But I think, communication is key, because it might seem that we're gonna, like the advisory committee and I and the board of selectmen, we're always like beating each other up, but we're really not. It's just like, then we go out drinking afterwards, because it's kind of funny. But we all have a common thing here to do, and that's to make sure that the town goes in the right direction, which should be forward, not backwards. I like going backwards at some things. I like the old days, but unfortunately, the only easy day was yesterday. So now we have to go forward. We have a lot of things going on in the town, and I'd like to know what's going on. School committee, what's going on in the school committee?
Well, we're educating your children the best that we can. We're doing a lot of great work, a lot of professional development happening. We're trying to get a new school built for our elementary kids.
Trying to get a new school built?
We are. Wow. Yeah. We're not. We're trying to support the town in that endeavor.
Right. Yeah, I bought my house in 2005 with the premise of a school being built in those.
I was on the original committee 7 years ago.
My son's now in high school, so my oldest is in high school. But I still have one in middle school and one in pre-K, so he's actually moving up to kindergarten to the middle school next year, which is
good. Where does that stand?
What's that?
The new school.
Where does it stand?
Yeah.
Are you asking me?
Yeah, I am asking you.
No,
where is it? Nothing's happening. Why is nothing
There's
happening?
No foundation, I can tell you that.
Yes, I know. Why is nothing happening? I guess is what I'd like to know.
I'm sure that's great, great questions asked. Mr. Tanzini, how would you like me to answer that? I mean, I can't answer it if you want, if it's okay with you. Okay, great. So basically what happens now is on the 19th of December, there's actually a meeting with the MSBA in Boston.
January.
Yeah, you've got to push to
January.
Late this afternoon.
Oh, today.
Just today.
Oh, really?
Oh.
All right, so now in January. See, communication is key, right?
Yes.
All right, so in January, the MSBA is going to meet with the Board of Selectmen, Chair, maybe another member, the Building Committee. Who's on the board there? Who's going? You? Mr. Tanzini,
the Municipal Finance Oversight Board has requested the chairman of the board, some project proponents, project architect, the school business manager, myself, and the town treasurer to meet with them and our financial advisor.
In Boston in January.
So finances are what's holding things up, pretty much.
Yep, but we are on the right track.
Say that.
No, you didn't hear from me though. No. I'm telling you right now, we're on the right track.
Yeah,
and I'm
on
the right.
That
I can say that.
No,
and I can say that because I'm.
Supposed to be a school committee tonight.
What's that?
I'd like to know where the rest of the school committee is.
I'm sure
they weren't invited. Only the chair was invited, and she's away, so she asked me to come instead.
Okay, that's good to know. Good communication.
It's okay.
She said that she was the only one invited because I asked her that question.
And you brought coffee?
Oh, okay.
Well, no, I was at a meeting prior to this.
Oh, so she didn't bring it for the rest of us?
I'm sorry. I'll put it away.
No, it's okay.
I won't be rude.
I got water, so I'm good. Yes, sir.
2 weeks ago, the advisory board asked that the application to the MFOB, we get a copy of that. Since I hear that you're meeting with him, I take it that that's already gone in, and we have not got a copy of that.
I'll have to take a note on that. I'm not really sure.
That was in a taped meeting. That was communicated that we would get that.
Okay. All our meetings are taped, and I believe what you said. I'll make sure that happens, okay?
When it's completed and the agenda for that meeting is set and the date and time are set, be happy to forward.
There's been some miscommunication with them as far as it being on December 7th, which is also, you know, Pearl Harbor Day. Then it got moved to the 19th of December, and now today it got moved to January. So you can see there's some flex, so just bear with us. We're not going to hold anything back from the advisory committee, that's for sure. We need you guys on board. Any other question with the schools?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
Well, since they passed, everything now is all set. Seems like every time we go through this obstacle or whatever the hurdle, they say we're all set. But now, see, it seems like it's dragging out. I thought it was all set for financing and everything. And everybody says, what's going on? I mean, now, we're already way behind where we're going to start this thing. And if it goes this, it's going to be 3 years, 4 years before the schools are even built up there. And I don't think that's unacceptable, I think.
There's a lot of, there's been a calamity of errors, I guess you want to call it. There's been a calamity of errors. So, obviously it had no fault to the Board of Selectmen. It had no fault to, one person, so we can't take all of the pitchforks and chase them down. I think, Templeton by nature has always been like a plan A town.
Yeah.
Just plan A.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
Just plan A. There's no plan B, there's no plan C, and there's no contingency of plan D. There's none. It's just plan A. So if plan A falls to shit, then we're screwed because we don't even have a plan B.
Yeah.
So what happened was plan A was with our previous town administrator, interim town administrator, had a great plan.
Yeah.
Had a great plan. It was on writing, good plan. I saw it.
Yeah.
The police station with 99 cents for 2 years, good plan. Rolling into the third year when the school would catch up, knowing the fact that 58 cents from the high school, middle school would fall off, knowing the fact that this was going to happen. It was a great plan. It all came together. And everybody's like, oh, it's only $1.74. And it was like all this $1.74 stuff. And I say, well, but what wasn't explained to the people was, it wasn't really $1.74. It was like $2.25. But that was because you wouldn't feel, the only thing that you would feel as citizens of the town was the $1.74 hit. You weren't going to feel that because you're already paying the 58 cents for the last 30 years.
Right.
But that wasn't explained to the people. So, I mean, in retrospect, I mean, I wasn't here, so I don't, I mean, I was here, but I wasn't part of the organization to make any type of choices with my fellow selectmen, so I don't know. But what I can tell you is, I mean, going forward, there is a plan A that we're working on right now, but we also have plan B and a contingency plan C. So, so if one installs the other one, then we can always fall back on that.
Well, I was just under the impression that MSBA, everything was all set with MSBA.
Yep. Well, after the citizens' petition that happened, that went to the special town meeting, they pretty much, it sparked their antenna and got them concerned.
Yep.
So now we have to, I say we collectively, the town has to go explain to the MSBA what our plan A is, what our plan B is, and what our contingency plan C is, and what to absorb funding for the $47 or $48 million school.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Could you going on that question, that's the Municipal Finance Oversight Board. And the reason why, you should explain to them why we have to go to them, because of the state law that basically says that if we go over 5% of the EQV, that we have to take and end up going to them for them to approve us to get a bond rating.
Yeah. To
borrow the money.
Yeah, what he's referring to is, the debt ceiling of the community, because we're worth about $600 million, and we have, we can only have so much debt based on our percentage. It's like a house. You know, and no matter what you do, the rest of what I explain is like, yeah, you own a house, you pay a mortgage. You could buy a new car, right? You pay on the car, and your interest rate in the car is probably okay. But then you go buy a motorcycle the next week. Well, obviously, you get more high risk, right? So your interest rate is going to be a little bit higher. The same thing applies to the community. It's just in larger numbers. We're not going to this meeting because of the debt ceiling. Our debt ceiling, we are way below the 5% based on the outside debt and inside debt of the community. Outside debt meaning like all the enterprise fund debts, which has no control over the debt ceiling for us. Even though we're still mandated by federal statute to maintain those debt management, the debt itself for the enterprise funds, but it doesn't affect the town's debt ceiling for borrowing money with the bond rating. Bond Council has been notified. I mean, we are working that, and more information to follow on that. Well, but thank you for bringing that up. Yes,
can I just add to that? But we did originally think that we might have to apply for an exemption for the school. However, I came to subsequently learn that statute provides that bonding for the construction of schools is automatically outside of the debt limit. So this issue of approval to go outside the 5% limit is no longer the case. The specific reason that we are going to the Municipal Finance Oversight Board is that there is a provision of statute that provides us to borrow under the Guaranteed Bond Act. Essentially, what this says to a lender is you don't need to worry about Templeton repaying you because we, the state, are guaranteeing it, because if they don't pay you, we will intercept their local aid payments and pay this bond. So whether we get the local aid and make the payment, or the state intercepts the local aid and makes the payment, in either way, the lender is guaranteed that they're going to get their payments. Think of having your wages, think of having a guaranteed job, and that you authorize an automatic withdrawal from your account to pay for your car or your mortgage or something like that. The other great thing about this is that it will give us a bond rating. We would expect to get a Moody's bond rating as a result of this approval if we are successful. And that bond rating is one grade below that which the Commonwealth of Massachusetts normally would get on its general obligation bonds. So it's a way to get us a bond rating, a very favorable bond rating, and to provide an assurance to prospective lenders that they can feel comfortable in lending to us. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So can I add, thank you for that clarification. I find with communication that you ask the question, you sort of give an answer, you sort of have an answer, and then we get the real answer. That needs to be put out in the public, the real answer. Not well, that we believe that we're outside the debt ceiling, and I'm not picking on you, Will, because I didn't understand that either. But the public is asking questions. If you're asking questions, we cannot continue to just sort of answer questions. They want to know, and they deserve an answer. And you know what? The truth right now is ugly. And that's just the way that it's going to be. It's very, very ugly. And if we don't start just saying the truth, okay, so there was more than one calamity. We're not starting a school because we can't borrow. It's as simple as that. This will allow us to borrow. And the longer we continue to just not say things, or say things that are sort of truth, omitting things, the public is, they don't deserve that. They deserve more. It's a $47 million project. There are errors that have been made in the budget. Let's not guess anymore. Let's just say it. Why were they made? The public deserves that. We answer to them. So I would rather just, now that Dennis asked the question and you sort of answered, and I would rather see that in the weekly report than whether or not checks got cut, you know, to certain departments. You know, Well, I mean, the weekly reports are great, but that's the stuff that the public really wants to know. You know, we don't want to go to a blog and read one thing, or go to a Facebook page and read something different. And, you know, it's not fair. It's not fair. So as committees, this is where I feel like, you know, I would ask the question as a board member, what do you want from us? We're the people who, you know, that it all comes to us in the end, and we're responsible for that, and we have to take ownership of that. So what do you want from us? That's what I would like to ask today.
That's a good call. And also, those minutes, well, those weekly reports are posted online, the website, so they are open to the public. Mm-hmm. So make sure that you know, the people understand and know that. Yeah. Yes?
I have a question regarding that, your statement. Does that mean that any form of state reimbursement might be subject to being withheld to pay off our debt?
Under the statute, it's our local aid payment, our unrestricted aid to local governments.
Including like highways and...
It's the unrestricted. Chapter 90 is not subject, as I understand it, Chapter 90 is not subject to intercepts. Any payment that's being made for a subsidy for sewer or water rates is not subject to intercepts. Chapter 70, which is the education funding, it's our unrestricted local aid, as I understand it, sir.
Yes.
You know, I think what we're doing here is good because this town for a long time has had a lot of controversy and kind of pushback, lack of communication. Everyone here represents an aspect of town, and they promote that aspect because that's what they're involved with, and rightly so. We shouldn't be on a committee if we don't have a passion for it and want to push for that. But we need to make sure that we communicate and understand the other issues in town. You know, I know that you know, we had some challenges in the past, even things like capital planning, where they weren't able to get a quorum of all the different areas to be able to gather that information.
We still don't.
And these areas, well, you know, these areas are important because, for instance, the school information coming to capital planning helps the town know, oh, we need to plan for this. You know, the fire department coming to capital planning, all these different areas, I don't know everyone that's on it, but when they come there, it helps the town. So, you know, this is the things that we need to do. We need to realize that although we're pushing for our item, and on the advisory board, you know, we take a lot of heat because we just look at numbers. We don't always deal with all the issues that are behind that, the personnel and that. You know, but we all have something we bring to the table, and as long as we can bring it out and communicate, and at the end of the day, like you said, go get a beer, that means that we're able to move forward and work together.
Absolutely. Yeah. May I just let Doug know that Ray Interflo is the school committee representative, and supposedly the office was called a couple months ago to let them know the town office. That's who it is. So we do have a rep.
And she's got herself sworn in.
Oh, she did.
Yeah, she met with me last week.
Very good.
Yeah, which was great. So what else is going on? Yes?
To the point earlier about these errors in the budget. Well, you know, from time immemorial...
Can I just remember... I'm sorry. I didn't wear my hearing aids, and I'm deaf, so speaking louder would be louder.
Okay.
Thank you.
You want one of mine? I said that.
Priscilla next to me can't hear either.
I said that there was a point made about there being errors in the budget. Well, the fact is that every year you pass a budget at the annual town meeting and that's not set in stone. Things change. There's discrepancies for whatever reason. So you have a special town meeting in the fall and you have another special in the spring. That's the way the system works. So let's not over-dramatize the fact that there were a few discrepancies in the budget.
Moving on. Yes.
Well, just the discrepancies in budget. I've been on advisory boards or finance committees for other towns. We ended up having to assume the responsibility of developing the budget. It's obviously that's not applicable to this town. However, the former administrative assistant presented us with 20 different budgets. And when we offered to go in and to work with him in the development of the budget, I would say personally, I don't want to talk for anyone else, but I felt I was discouraged. So when you have 20 different versions of the same, and you see, I spoke to some of the department heads who talked to me and showed me what their requests had been, and the amounts that they had requested had been copied wrong and were not correct on the budget submitted. Too many cooks spoil the broth, but on the other hand, if you have several heads looking at the same thing, somebody can pick something up that maybe somebody else overlooked. Because it's a very complex budget. So therefore, it doesn't hurt to have several people looking at it and checking the details.
I got you. We have a pretty good strategy going forward. I think the interim TA's got a pretty good strategy. He's briefed most of the Board of Selectmen on it. Not just with a budgetary platform for the directorates to manage their budgets, to be held accountable and responsible for their budgets. One thing I can't, and I think that, again, the people have a right to know that if you go over your budget, you're done. That's it. I mean, when I went over my budget in the service, I would have been fired or put in jail, one or the other. People in this town go over the budget $10,000, $20,000. What happens?
Nothing.
You have 60 transfers at a special town meeting to take this one to this one. So you know what? I mean, managers have to be held accountable, responsible for their budgets. If they're not, then we're not doing that job.
That's right.
And that's what we're building right now with policies. Because if they're not able to be financially and fiscally responsible, then they should not be employed, period. Because they have a job to do. Yes, ma'am.
I want to tell you something.
Yep.
I've been kind of interested in politics for a long time. And being on the advisory board, I was on in the 70s when we met with all of the department heads.
Yep.
They brought in their budgets and they said, this is what we would like and this is why we would like it. Well, this year they were told not to come see us. Okay, that's all right. So we get 20 different changes in about a week and a half. So we made our own budget. If you guys don't agree, speak up. So finally, town meeting day comes, and I knew that our numbers were right. I was so upset after that meeting, I went in the bathroom and cried. You know why? I knew what it was gonna do to every one of your departments. And I knew that all these raises, we're going to kick the crap right out of you because the money has to come from somewhere and it's not coming from any place else but your pocket. They gave it to you and they have to take it back. And some departments that had nothing to do with it are going to suffer. But I have sat down and from 1991, we have not successfully had more than 5 years in a row without going broke. I told you, didn't I tell you? I'm putting a body in line as a sand. This is it, you gotta get it right.
Yep.
Because I can't stand this crap no more.
Well,
we are a laughing stock of the whole New England area. We do not have a nickel in stabilization. We can't do anything because we don't have any money. You can't ride down the road. So we have to get it right. We cannot spend more than we take in.
Yep.
And if we squeeze the people too much, the elderly are not going to be able to stay home. They're going to have to leave. They are not made of money. We do not have a lot of money in this town. Will gave us some paperwork, and it showed all of the different scales on new growth coming in.
Zero.
Anything you looked at, the number of kids going to school, a lot changes in 3 years. We got a paper from Carter, and it was, what was that the other day, where they had all the communities and how the peer communities? Ours isn't right. That's not our tax rate, and that's not our population. That was in 2013. I got one from a Worcester Telegram, I think that's the one that's right. People have left our town. I don't want people to have to leave our town.
Well, we have a...
But
let me just add something to what she's saying.
Go ahead, Bob.
On salaries.
Yeah, we
The perception has been in the budget, the two line items, salary and wages, last year and this year, adds up to $89,000. That's not totally the actual truth. Inside the budget, there is over $300,000 of increases to salaries besides those. It's on paper. You can look at this, people. You can go figure it out. You can see what departments have gotten large increases. To give a department head a large raise, a couple of them, and then that they can end up putting them on the bubble is not the right way that they can end up handling the town's business. My thing is that we asked, the bubble is basically that if we don't end up getting this thing under control, we're going to end up failing big time. My thing is, and I'm going to take and put it out to right in front of everybody again, the advisory board has asked the selectmen to meet. You have selectmen that do not want to meet. Every other community that you look at, you can go to their websites, they meet with the selectmen and the advisory committee or finance committee meet along with the school committee so that they can end up smoothing this out. In this community, since 2013, I've been a proponent of that, and it hasn't happened.
Can I just chirp in on that?
Sure.
As far as I'm aware, I haven't seen any invitation. I mean, I haven't seen an invitation that you'd like to come sit with us. I can tell you that I went to a couple of your advisory board meetings, and the tone in the room made me want to throw up. So I left, because you know what? I don't get paid for this. So you want to meet with us? Fantastic. Send a wonderful little invitation over here, and he'll send it to us, and we'll, I'm sure, think about saying, sure, let's sit down. But let's do it in a nice manner.
Well, it was
the tone right now is terrible.
Hey, Eddie, stop.
He's dead funny. He can't, he pops up because he can't
hear. Okay. Listen to what we're going to do. We understand there's an issue with finances in this community. There's no secret here. There's been no secret here. I remember standing here talking about my, with the Royers having that election, what do they call it? Candidates night here. And I think that they quoted me in saying, you don't have to be smarter than a fifth grader to know that this town is going to be in deep, deep trouble in 5 years. And, you know, I mean, and that's happening. We're in that issue right now. And it's, you know, it's like, you know, in 2014, we laid people off for a couple weeks. Okay, we kind of get back on track. Now it's like, well, let's lay more people off again. Again, it's Band-Aid after Band-Aid after Band-Aid. We have to do drastic changes in order to conceive the forward planning of this community. If we do not, then I would not want to be here by 2020, that's for sure. And that's just how it is. But moving on from finances, because we all know that there's a financial issue. But let's talk about some other issues that the other committees have, not just the FinCom. Yes.
I'm just curious, what's the plan for the new growth in town? Are we encouraging businesses to come in?
Well,
for businesses?
Well, one of the other committees I'm on the Economic Development Committee with Mr. Eaton back there, and we probably meet every other Wednesday, morning at 9 o'clock. And we are in the process of putting a package together to sell Templeton, so to speak. Not to like huge big business, but you know, like, we've got some areas of Templeton that could be utilized for new growth. You know, and keeping it the same small town USA that it is. You know, that's what we're working with. We're working with Brian and his team and the state. And, it's working, but you're looking at five-year plans when you talk about economic development. It doesn't happen like tomorrow. The results you see from planning today is going to happen 5 to 10 years from now.
But at least there's a plan.
Right, and we're working.
Hope that it's going to work.
And that's one of the reasons why the economic development community, that's been really, I'm really excited. I mean, Steve's on it, Steve Castle's on it. I mean, we really do a lot of, you know, great communication. We have great, best speakers that come in. I mean, developed the moves down the road here in Athol. You know, there's been a lot of good people that came in and spoke to us, and we're trying to put a plan together along with the major, what's that major plan, Glenn? Is that, what's the major plan? When's that being, January, February?
The site readiness program for mass development.
Yeah, the big mass development plan.
Yeah, they call it the site readiness program.
Okay, so yes. We have some things in the work right now that, you know, hopefully is going to come, you know, as far as grant money, so it's really no money from the town, but, you know, utilization of more grant money will hopefully inspire businesses to come here, because there is wet plateaus.
What's happening with the Farm School property? That's on state owned?
I believe so. I have no idea. Yes.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt. I spoke with, and I'm not great at names, I apologize, with the one of the unit directors at the Department of Capital Asset and Management midday today, following up on where is this, why has the development committee not met in quite some time. And he informed me, bad news, that the project manager is retiring. Good news, he's going to appoint a new project manager and convene a meeting of that group. Tentative dates are December 28 or 29. We'll lock that in over the next week or so once he decides who he's going to appoint as project manager. We will discuss the fact that before the state can really determine, this is all based upon the state determining what portion, if any, or all of the property it can declare a surplus, and in what packages. Some buildings might need to go with a certain amount of land, some raw land might go out, and then put that through a compliant recruitment process or advertisement process in keeping with Chapter 30B, which controls how the state can dispose of property. Frankly, that will mean the need for some money. So I encourage them to please, by all means, let's get this done before the end of the year and to try to have some sense of what dollar amount is required so that in the invite, when we have hopefully the senator and the representative meet with the select board in early January, you have something on your wish list that you can turn over to them. That's the best I can tell you right now, and I will make sure that news makes it into the weekly this coming week.
Thank you. Yes, Beth.
I attended some meetings. Mr. Columbus is supposed to be the chairman, so he can speak to this also. I was told because the sex offenders were staying up at the Frontal School, nothing could go there unless it can coexist with them. So they hold the cards as far as that goes. That's what we were told.
Well, that would
and
be.
It revolves around them, so.
That would have to be part of the master planning process, highest and best use. I've done a number of these when I worked with the state's formerly Department of Environmental Management and with Lawrence and Fall River and some others when I was doing urban renewal and community development. These processes are not fast. They do take some time, but at least we have got their attention again today, get this meeting here later this month, and do our best to get the attention of the senator and the representative, and let's try to get the money that we need into the state budget, because frankly, that's going to drive it all. With no dollars in the budget, the project simply will not move at all. And in 2 years, you'll be asking the next TA what the status of the project is. Hopefully, we can set you up so that they can report on the results of the study instead of a.
I don't think they still want it to move. I really don't.
That's that. So what else is going on with you?
I'd like to back up a minute and touch base on the readiness, the site readiness program the state has.
Yep.
Did any of the other members watch the webinar Friday? Anybody?
No.
Nobody. Okay.
I think
that's
the session.
Oh, hey, buddy.
I did.
Nobody
else raised their hand.
What I took from that was that The state is just waiting for somebody to, hey, come help me.
Yeah.
Are we, hey, come helping me?
We are working that, yeah.
I'm wondering what.
We are working that. Obviously, with the Economic Development Committee, where there's two major areas, one off Route 20, which is owned by the Cooperative Bank, the old sheep farm, I guess it's called. It's got some acres there. And that's mainly economic, that's our focus, that's our plan A right there, that area right there. For a couple of reasons, it's got fiber, water, and electric right there, so it's a huge selling point. And having this organization come in and help us develop that would be fantastic, and hopefully to sell it to someone that doesn't need infrastructure, someone that can come in and bring their own infrastructure with them. Because there's two different types of groups. There's groups that, you know, that want the building, mm-hmm. and there's groups that don't want, they just want land. So like a Home Depot could come in and just put their own stuff in.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Yeah. That type of growth.
Well, there's also facilities that have been abandoned in town. Mm-hmm. And one of them I worked for 17 years, American Tissue Mills. That facility owns a fairly big piece of property, the old Temple Stewart's mm-hmm. area. And I think that one should be spearheaded to get something happening with it for two reasons. One is because it's a thorn in the side of the town's budget every year. The amount of taxes that we were supposed to get from there, we spend. I think we spend them, right? Up to the tune of $500,000. So I don't know where we got the $500,000 from there to spend, but we spent it. Whether we ever see it or not is besides the point, but to cap it and start to a process to do something with that land, both parcels, one, the old mill on Mill Street and the Temple Stewart's project, there's a rail site there, which got to have some value to somebody when it comes to movement of product.
I think we talked about that, didn't we, Glenn?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. That has been breached.
From what I gathered, the webinar Friday, they're waiting for people to call them.
They're drooling. I know. I got the same approach.
Next year, they're going to have more funds than this year, and more the year after, because it benefits them as well as the community.
Well, just us getting on websites, just getting us get on to the Mass State land awareness websites, where corporations throughout the United States and the world pretty much can look at different areas that have different acreage and sites and with what type of, you know, electric power and water sewer that's there. And they see that stuff. And, you know, Massachusetts sells what steers them in the different directions where they want to be. And off the Route 2 corridor, I mean, we're pretty decent.
Okay. Twofold with the American Tissue plant.
Yep.
It's going to get the thorn out of our side, which we desperately need.
Yep.
And the other thing is the pollution area, or the pollution problem there, the state can come in and help with too.
I have an update on that if you want me to read it.
Sure.
Five of the 20 parcels have been sent to Landport. It's a lengthy and a costly process, 2 plus or minus years. It's further complicated by an error in the original tax deeding of 15 of those parcels, which we now have to back up and correct and start anew. So that's a few year process.
No.
There is a second course of action for 20 plus or minus parcels under the second process that we can hopefully get certified for sale.
Yeah. Part of the readiness thing could be to take care of some of that.
Some of that, yeah.
But if they don't know,
that's where that's at.
If they haven't been contacted with the specifics,
we're working it.
They want a phone call.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Yes.
I had a talk with Luann about that property. We are still billing for that, you know. We're sending bills out. Mm-hmm. Luann, what's he owe? $800,000?
Yeah, probably.
Never mind the $400 or $500 that he owes for interest that we'll never get.
Yeah.
Well, Gardner just went and got a grant to take care of one of their properties. It's going to be, it's been cleaned up. Now they're going to seed it and they're going to sell it.
Yeah.
So the guy's in jail. I don't know what you have to do, maybe send somebody over to punch him in the head to get him to sign a release or something out here. But really and truly, it's a blight to the whole neighborhood, and it's the better of the properties that there are that you can actually use for something that maybe can hire a few people and make some money.
It's a valuable piece of property. That's good. Okay, Glenn's already got it, we're gonna talk more about it. So what else, as far as communication before we move on, anything else? Health department, you guys have anything? How's the health of the town?
Yeah, we're, you know, on top of the normal inspectional services, they've been working with the state attorney general's office, abandoned housing.
Yeah.
Taking quite a few of those to housing court, trying to get them into receivership. Doing some really good work with that. Had a couple bulky waste days, trying to set up a hazmat day. You know, trying to find money for that.
Right.
Quite a bit going on, got another meeting this week.
Great. Do you have anything to ask any of the other committees? That's why we're here, any help that you need? I mean, do you have other goals that you guys are looking at down the road?
I mean, that really, that would be a better question for Jane, our chairperson. She can't make it tonight, but kind of sitting in for it.
Okay.
When's your meeting this week?
Thursday.
Thursday.
Anybody else have any other things to talk about? How about the potential restructuring of the community? What's everybody's thoughts on that?
My thought is I want to go sit in the back room.
That's what I thought you would like. Yeah.
Steve and I decided to open up Scout Hall as a visitor center and get our Cub Scouts back in there.
There you go.
Taking down walls weekly, looking nice over there. All with grant money, thanks to the voters, so.
Yep.
We're excited about that. We're hoping it's going to open in the spring.
It's coming along.
It is.
Nice.
I'll tell you one thing, John. Everybody in town is fed up because no matter what we do, we're going backwards financially. I mean, you cut this, cut that. And that is not even having a balanced budget since 13. That is a disgrace to this town. And all these other towns, they don't have any problem with this. And it seems like they keep saying, okay, it's going to be balanced. Now, I was sitting right in this room 2 years ago, and I was told the 13 budget would have been done at the end of that year, and it still isn't done yet. That was 2 years ago.
Now, I met with the advisory committee a long time, you know, the first time we met with the advisory committee, and you know, I apologize.
Yeah.
I had nothing to do with it because I wasn't even here.
Yeah.
And I apologize because, again, I mean, you can only, you know, that was plan A.
Yeah.
And they didn't have plan B or contingency plan C. So, you know, there's a lot, but again, to correct you, I have to correct you. There's a lot of towns that are worse off than Templeton, believe it or not. In the States.
Excuse me, these people over here are being rude. I can't even hear what they're saying. If they're not gonna, you need to shut up, and if you're not gonna shut up, you're gonna have to leave.
Thank you.
Why are you so rude?
I got it, thank you. So basically, there are other towns that are the same issues that we have, financial issues. I mean, Winston next door, had to use some state money, $5 million. Spencer. That was like 50 million or something. Well, it was something crazy.
When I went there, we were on the edge of receivership.
Yeah, I mean, and you know what? I mean, we're not there yet as far as, you know, the R word, meaning receivership. But again, if we don't do drastic changes, because again, all we've done in the past, and it's nobody's fault. I mean, it's like everybody like wants to point the finger at one person. And I'm not going to talk about finances after this. So we're not going to talk about finances. Once I'm done, we're done with finances. So basically what happens is you use free cash and you supplement it to your budget. Your operating budget. That's beyond wrong. Using grant money as your operating budget. Now, some grant money has to because it's geared towards that by the contract that you sign. But you know what? I mean, not level funding budgets. Not holding people accountable responsible for going over budgets. There's a whole bunch of things that go on. But I'm telling you, it's being fixed. I know it doesn't seem like much now, but we are working together. Collectively to get it fixed because we already voted to have a budget that's going to be level funded. We have to stop this somewhere, and people are going to cry, and people are going to get mad. But you know what? If we don't do something now, in 5 years, the R word's going to smack Templeton right in the face because all you're going to do is put band-aids on it for, oh, let's lay people off this week for 2 weeks. Oh, next week, let's lay people off for 4 weeks. The next year, let's lay them off for a month. Oh, the next year, let's lay them off for 2 months. But it doesn't work. It doesn't fix the problem. Right. So that's finances. So let's talk about something else. Council on Aging. You guys got a lot of stuff going on. The whole siding issue. That's a nightmare.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's a town issue.
It's a town issue. I love it. I mean,
it's the Council on Aging issue. It's a town issue.
It's a town building. It's a town structure.
We built a $3 million building less than $500,000 from the taxpayers.
Wait a minute, we gave we went over money twice, I think, for the senior center.
Nope.
You talking about the Dave Mill thing?
Taxes from the county.
Yeah, and then Dave Mill gave 200.
Grant funds for another 640,000.
Yep. And then there was Dave Mill.
Private funding and grant funding than there has been town funding.
Right. But I want to, you know, obviously there's other tax money that's involved here, not maybe specifically mine, like I told Doug, because Doug was like, only 500,000 was a tax exclusion for the town. Yeah, but you know, Dave Mill had to come up with 250.
No, that was a contractor.
Understood.
Contractor.
Yep. I know. I read the thing. And then we had that Senator Brewer gave up $300,000 of taxpayers' dollars. So maybe not collectively my tax dollars, I don't know. I mean, collectively, I think it's mass stat tax dollars, but still, it's still tax dollars.
Right.
So,
I paid those taxes too.
Sure, we all do. That's taxes, bro.
Where did the money come from? The highway department. I worked up there all summer. Where did that money come from?
That was town money.
Okay, so how much that would have been if they had it?
I didn't put that in there, but again, we all have to work together.
Yeah.
Meaning, you utilizing the town, utilizing the resources that we have within the town, to benefit all of us. I mean, the work that was and the money that was saved to conserve, thanks to a lot of people, the East Templeton School to make as the town hall, there was a lot of engineering work that was done there. And it was all done by the town town highway department.
Right. Speaking of East Templeton.
Yes.
You really don't want to open that can of worms.
Oh, no.
You know, most of that work that was done over that 7-week period was done by people that were laid off. You realize that?
Yes.
All that hand chipping of paint, Dave and I did that. Will was up there. There were a couple other volunteers.
Yep. And Julie was up there a lot. Julie was up there. You were up there painting all day.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember.
Julie was there.
Yeah, she was. I was there too. I was helping. Put some sheetrock up. Believe me, I got it. Yes, Mr. Tenzi.
I would just like to go back, if I might,
yep.
To the gentleman's question about the road project this summer. I believe he's referring to Hubbardton Road, Hubbardston.
No,
he meant the senior center.
He meant the senior center.
Center.
They did the highway department did the layout, the drainage and all that stuff, where they did a great job, and that was, I understand where you're going with that.
Two of the highway department employees took vacation time and worked on the...
Mark and Bud.
Yeah, worked on the...
I donated some time there too.
Right.
But I think you could say the highway department saved that project probably
half a million
from 200 to, I had to estimate exactly what a contractor would have charged, but I would say close to 300 grand anyway. On a bad day, it would have been that.
Okay.
Now, we're not a construction company, but we performed like one.
Exactly.
I think you could drive in there and say, wow, somebody really did a nice job on this. Other than the looks of the siding of that place, it's a number one unit. I mean, it's not a B-grade project. It was done right. It's functional.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And 90% of the building does have siding on it. T111 is siding.
Oh, I understand that.
Yep. Yeah. No, I got it. And that's we're going to be working on that.
But I thought we were going to talk finance.
We're not. That's what we're moving on right now. So what other good things does the Council on Aging do?
We're getting ready for a Christmas party this week, Thursday. The Ryan Patrick Jones Foundation, the lieutenant from Westminster, his family has that foundation. They're throwing a Christmas party for the seniors. The food pantry has 42 children that we're trying to provide Christmas for. So we have mittens on the tree that you can come in and pick a child and provide Christmas. This year, we've never had so many kids.
You sent that to Carter as far as for the weekly newsletter?
No.
Can you do that?
I don't advertise things like that.
It's not really advertised, just let people know that's
I'm not going to exploit those kids. I'm sorry.
I just want them to know that if you want to take a mitten off the tree, it's available at the Council on Aging building. If you want to pay, do so much, some type of assistance. So if the town doesn't know, then you're not going to have a lot, you still have a lot of mittens on the tree.
We have a lot of foot traffic.
Okay.
They'll be taken care of.
Okay, that's all I care about.
Sorry, Julie was.
Yep.
You're going to have that bake sale suite thing, right?
Yep, the Sugar Rush is the 17th.
Is the tree going to be available at that point?
Yep. A lot of public will be in then. This Saturday, we're having the open house and Sugar Cube building. We're dedicating the, we have an art gallery that we're opening. We have the paintings all hung. The public is coming in for the dedication of the art gallery and the grand opening. It's pretty exciting. Bricks are still being sold for the brick wall at $75 each. That brick wall is going up here shortly. And
that's good.
The vets still meet on the last Thursday of the month. And we play cribbage, pitch, and we have bingo every week. We're starting the stained glass class on Wednesday afternoons. Rick Turpolo is teaching that. He used to be on the Board of Health. That's pretty exciting. A lot of good stuff going on.
Oh, okay. All right, so what else is happening out there?
So I agree that I don't really know everything that you said, John, but that would be good. That wasn't in the weekly report.
No.
So as far as the tree, maybe employees or board or committee members would want to come in. So if Holly, if Carter approves that, could send out like what's happening in the next coming week, that we could come and take a mitten or come and participate, or I didn't know about any of that. Sorry.
That's okay.
So if you could forward something, I think that, I mean, I would definitely help.
Okay.
Definitely.
Maybe just even to the director.
I know that, unfortunately, you talked about like giving Christmas to kids. The school is doing a huge, I think this year they need 140 baskets and they don't have enough food. So there's a list. There is, if somebody, I don't know if I can send that out, or Holly can send that out. They're now extended it through December 9th. There are a lot of needy families in this community.
Yeah, we're actually, the food.
Are you helping with that?
We're actually taking some food to the school.
Anything would be appreciated.
Yep. Open forum. Anybody can say whatever. That budget stuff, I don't want to talk about money.
I don't know how many people know about
conservation.
About property that we have on the Dudley Road with the help of DCR and CPC and Highway Department. We finally put a gate up at the Dudley Road side so people don't keep going down out back with their vehicles to make a mess from that side.
We did.
Yes, we did.
Is that on the Leclerc side?
No.
It's on the other side.
Lawrence side.
Okay.
So that was the Leclerc side, they'd already put that gate down. But they were going down off the Dudley Road side, and one of the people sunk a seat almost up to the windshield, and they had to go down into the tow truck and tow it out. And it made it even worse. At least the gate is now up, so. Hopefully we'll have less problems.
Is there still trash back there?
Oh, there's plenty of trash back there.
That might be something for the Cub Scouts, Boy Scouts to get involved in next spring.
Either
or something.
That or the Sheriff's Department. I was thinking they want to project next year.
Yeah.
Yeah, just, we still need to walk off the other end, which we will.
Is that the gate you got from the MWR?
Yes.
The free gate that we got from them?
Yeah. Yes.
So we still need another gate?
Another gate down back with a bunch of cement block to. We have 48 feet that they can come in off the river.
Okay.
They go down and
well, just bring, get that up to, get that information up to the Board of Selectmen office so we know what's going on.
We've been working on it for 2 years now. We finally at least got one gate up and then the other end of the
That's a long time.
It's too long.
Yeah. Yeah, every time someone says something, it's like, oh, geez, that takes a long time. Oh, that's Templeton. I hate that saying. It really bothers me when people say that. It's like, come on, people. All you got to do is pick up the phone and talk to the guy next to you or the girl next to you. That's all you got to do. I mean, things can work a lot faster than they need to work.
I was just brought up to the other administrator. He had all the photos 2 years ago. Apparently, it was set aside.
Again, priorities are priorities. And obviously, I don't know how, I mean, our interim TA is now. I mean, he's like a magician.
But the point was, people are still going out there. They're walking down with their shotguns and they've got target practice down there. They've been doing that for 30 years.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you can always let local law enforcement know.
Well, they know that.
Okay.
Like they said, they can't always catch anybody down there because by the time they get there, they're gone.
I got you. You got
it. I think a lot of the conservation area, part of the problem is if it's not posted for certain things, restrictions or don't do this, don't do that, then when Mike gets in there, it's all he can do is get out of here.
You mean there's no signage?
Yes, sir. There's one sign on one end. There's none down at the park end.
Well, where we put the gate in for you, this does is say...
In the parking lot right there, there is a sign that was put up there 4 years ago.
But I don't believe
it's,
I don't believe it says any restriction on it.
And it says no vehicles and things like that.
I mean, people can walk back there. You just can't use firearms. There's like, you don't have a sign with like, you know, with a gun with no, with a cross on it. You know what I mean? Don't do this. Maybe some signs. Maybe you can work that well with the highway department. I don't know. I mean, work with each other. You know, find a way. Communicate. I know, but 2 years is a long time.
It is.
It's a long time. And if the chief goes down there and there's guys down there shooting, they can be down there. I mean, all he's going to do is say, get out of here. There's nothing he can do because there's no trespassing. There's no, you know what I mean? I mean,
yeah, if you're coming from Berry Road, there's no signs, there's no gate, no nothing.
A lot has to do with DCR because they own the railroad bit.
I know.
They should have signs up there.
They should, and maybe that's something you can prop them a little bit. You know, give them a little prod.
Well, I have
maybe you need
a bigger prod.
Part of the access to the other end is a right of way for the farmer.
Right, and that's why he's got access to the gate.
You'd have to give him a key or whatever.
Yes, he would have access to the, he needs access to that gate.
Yeah.
Without saying. All right, yeah. What else is going on? Cemetery. How's things going over there?
Just normal working and stuff, clean up, and we just repaired some stones in the back of this common cemetery that were lean. We were fairly good to snap off at the bottom. So, you know, we just did the Christmas tree lighting for the town this weekend. That was a cool event. Quite a few people in the town center for the Jack Frost Festival. We worked well with the light department, putting the lights up, and Historical Society that's on the Jack Frost Festival. So we kind of communicate with a lot of different patterns.
You should speak about the new tool you have to light the tree.
The box.
The special box.
The special. Yes, that was very nice.
That will be delivered to the selectman's office probably tomorrow. So I'm hoping we can display that at town hall for the residents to come and see and introduce each year.
I want to get the measurements. I like to get maybe a glass cover that goes on top of it. So I'll put it on the glass so people don't play with it. That's nice. It was a donated box. It was really nice. I thought it was nice. Very nice. It was a good gesture.
The bandstand looks nice, though.
Yeah, thanks to the Lions.
That is done with the Lions Club, which again, we coordinate with them with their Christmas tree sales on the common and their bandstand and doing that. So there's not only interdepartmental cooperation across the town, but there's private entities that we work with as well. So it's all about community.
I want to thank him for doing what he's done for us too.
He's done a lot. He's done a lot for the community, that's for sure. Ron, how's water?
Pretty good.
Can we drink it?
Yeah.
Anything big going on the water side in town?
Yeah, the water tank's almost done. Should be done by before the first of the year.
Okay.
neighbors up there are very happy with the company that's doing the work up there. They've had nothing but good things to say about them. We've been in the process of installing new water meters in some of the homes now, and all the businesses. They're 15 years old already, so we have to start putting new ones in again.
Are those drive-by ones, where you can read them when you drive by?
Yes. It takes 2 days to read the meters now, where before it used to take 6 months. We just finished flushing all the hydrants in town, winterizing the hydrants. I know you don't want to talk about finances, I heard you say that, but because we're going in homes and going into businesses, people that come into the water department or the light department to pay their water bills, so a lot of people that wouldn't mind going up in their taxes to pay for the services that they need in this town. They don't want to lose their service. But what they do want is the truth on what happened with the money. If somebody could put something together and say what happened, because it's been a couple of years now that it was out there when almost the whole town was shut down because of the loss of the $505,000, and nothing's been mentioned about it. So people are like, you know, if you just say what happened, we don't mind paying extra in our taxes to keep the services. They don't think it's fair for the people that work hard in this town to take that cut because of somebody else. And a lot of these guys, you know, have been here more than 15 years working for the town. And they're going to lose their job, and they think it's wrong.
No, you're right.
I mean, I hear it all the time, you know.
I think that all starts with the audits. You can't tell a whole story until the audit tells you what it's going to
do. That's correct.
Well, you have people that do know where the money went and not saying anything.
Well, I can tell you this, and take it from what I'm saying.
Okay.
Put that camera on my face. If somebody did something wrong, the Worcester County DA's office would have been notified a long time ago. Okay? If somebody broke the law and money was taken from this town illegally, they would be in jail. So all the mistakes and calamity of errors that happen are not because of potentially maybe one person, it might be a group of people. There were errors made. Errors across the board. I mean, is the sword popping yet?
Yes.
Where's the sword? Hey, there you are, yeah. There it is, Tom. Yeah, so with sewer issues and, you know, I mean, not that they did anything wrong, it's just like there was an oversight. You missed one oversight. Well, that oversight's, you know, a couple $1,000s. Well, those couple thousand add up. And next thing you know, it's 60,000. It's like, oh my God. You know, and that's what happens. It's like the focus isn't where it needs to be. And once you lose sight of the bubble, you know, that's what happens. I hate to say it. And then the overestimation. I mean, when you overestimate new growth, when you overestimate, you know, excise tax or property tax, and what that does at the end of the year, because again, when you think about how budgets work, especially municipal budgets, it's like monopoly money. It's like a guesstimation. Like, I'm guesstimating we're going to get X amount of dollars next year based on what people pay. Now, what if everybody doesn't pay? That money's not there. So you overestimated X, and only Y came in. Now you're short. So that's what happens. I mean, people being conservative, being what they are. I mean, mistakes happen, and you know, you're right. The people do have a right to know. But right now, we can't tell you. I can tell you that nobody's going to jail. I can't tell you that the audits are being done. I can't tell you that that's happening. I can't tell you that we are on the right track. I mean, collectively, with all the selectmen, we're on the right track. We're doing the right things for the right reasons. The decisions we're making are for the right reasons. And some people might not like them, but that's why they elected us, to make the tough decisions. And you know what? And we will stand by the decisions that we make. Because that's the other thing. Everybody's afraid to make a decision around here. Well, let the next guy do it. Like, no, the buck has to stop somewhere. And if you don't like it, I'm sorry, I'll explain it to you, but it has to stop somewhere. And that's how it is. You know what I mean? But you're right, Ron. I mean, the people have every right to know, and having a special town meeting, an annual town meeting, and maybe having the cable company do some talk shows with each of the Board of Selectmen members, maybe, and asking questions, and maybe we can get some answers that way, or with the town administrator, you know, put some stuff out there on Channel 8, you know, put some stuff here on the nuclear letter that Mr. Tanzini puts out. I mean, all that stuff adds up. I mean, how much more transparency has Templeton been since the last year? I mean, how much more transparent has it been? Yeah.
it's hard to underestimate. The enormity of the problem is that we had no auditable books for two fiscal years. We have an accountant who's trying to keep the current books in order, and she was trying to also go back and not reconstruct, but construct books for two fiscal years. We ended up, because of that, we ended up on the advice of DOR of bringing in some outside people, and I think we, at special town meeting, appropriated, I want to say $100,000, but I might be wrong. We spent roughly $100,000 on outside people coming in to do the books. So that's where we're at now. Like, I think Dave's right, we really can't know anymore until we have the audits done, which hopefully are going to be soon. And then hopefully the management letters are going to lay out what the problems were, and we can go from there. But until they're done, we're pretty much at a standstill.
But you're right, Ron. I mean, the finance team.
Well, I don't mind knowing that there's something I can do to help you to get the word out there. I'll do it, you know?
I mean, the finance team that was in place at the time, it was come and go. There was like two treasurers, there was a couple accountants, some were part-time, some were not, well, less than part-time. I mean, it was just so many different hands in the cookie jar, not taking anything, but just errors made. But we're going to move on. What's that?
They were moving.
Yes. They were moving. Yes. Hold on. Yes.
What you keep saying is errors made. And with all due respect, and it's nobody's fault. Who's the oversight for this? If I walk into my boss's office and say, in my division there's errors made, but it's nobody's fault.
Yep.
It's my fault. I'd like to know who the oversight is so we can stop making these errors and fix it.
Yep.
But when you keep saying there's errors made, but it's nobody's fault.
I'm saying
it has to be somebody's fault. The error was made.
What I'm saying is errors in the past, but the buck stops with the Board of Selectmen. The budget becomes ours.
Then
am I right, Diane? Is that how that works? The budget becomes ours, and we have to be held accountable and responsible when we, and again, not just us, but then the directorates that have their budgets, they have to be held accountable, and that also hasn't happened. Like I said earlier, I mean, if I went over my budget by a dollar, I probably wouldn't have a job. But there's directorates in this town that have been over, you know, a couple hundred bucks, $1,000, $10,000 over the last, you know, 4 or 5, you know, 6 years. I mean, and nothing happens, but they just play the shuffleboard game of moving money from Paul to pay Paul, and then to pay Anthony, to pay John, you know what I mean? And it's like, at the end of the day, it's like, what the heck is going on here? This is not right. That's why we are trying to fix it now. It's gotta be fixed.
I agree it has to be fixed, and I have to say, I agree that you're trying, but we have to hold somebody responsible.
Right, I understand.
Because we can't come back here next year and hear there were mistakes made, but it's nobody's fault.
Well, now with the level funding process of the budget, which is gonna be across the board, where the board is not gonna prioritize the organizations and the services within the community and how we prioritize those services. Not that we want to deprecate any service in this community, because that's not our intention, but if we have to condense or, what's the word I'm looking for?
Consolidate
without interrupting services. That's like my biggest thing. I mean, I don't want services to be deprecated in any way, but if they have to be like tweaked a little bit, then, you know, to where we need to, and it's not about saving like for the gap that we have right now. I'm talking about the gap that we're walking into when 18, and 18's not even here yet. I'm not even gonna discuss that with you. And then going into 19, you know, then 20. So whatever decisions that we have to make as a Board of Selectmen, we're trying to make them for the benefit of all the people. Right, Diane? Mm-hmm. Can you help me?
Help you with what? help you with what? I mean, I think that, yes, somebody has to be held accountable. I have to agree with you.
Yes.
Fully agree. Looking for who a that person is? I mean, we're a municipality. So where does that start? So I don't have an answer for you for that, period. Do I agree with what you say? I hear a lot of residents say that, and you're absolutely right. So are there some things in paperwork that could be put out? Yes. Has it already been done? Yes, Julie knows that. We all know where that is. It's not, nobody's hand was in the cookie jar. it's oh, well, I forgot to put this down on the tax recap sheet. I forgot to, okay, so debt exclusion numbers were wrong. Period. End. So if you don't have the right debt exclusion number, now we have a deficit in our budget. Oh, who's responsible for that? So aside from that, as far as the other things about merging departments, I always think that I've thought long and hard about this. I feel like, you know, Bev, where it's really, this has been like an emotional roller coaster since I've been on the board. Crisis after fight with people after. I'm tired of it, period. We shouldn't have to do that. We should, you know, I don't really see what would be the problem if we agree, but who am I to say I'm Miss Pollyanna? But it's a matter of when you're in this place, I feel like it's growing pains, and we have an opportunity to make our government maybe better. I don't want to get rid of people. I don't want to. We have some of the best employees around, period. You know, we are on town administrator number two. I love Carter's style. Very OCD,
yes.
Anal retentive, but oh, yeah. You know, but you know what we get?
Except my desktop.
And I mean that in a very, please, in the beginning I was like, I'm not gonna trust you. I was pretty honest about that, and that's just me. But, you know, when you look at the weekly reports, I think that it's a good way to communicate. I think that, yeah, I will, I came, Gordon, and I said to you in the beginning, our employees have not been treated very well by the committee in years past. And that's a fact. So what? Those words that were in the email were mine, and I owned that. I'm not going to just let stuff go to not come to you. I just wanted it to be that we were trying to do a new way to do the budget. I think it was lost before, and then for us to do it and then come to you. That didn't work out too well, did it? Not for me, and not for anyone else. So I think it's a matter of where do we go from here? Merging departments. I mean, you know what? We have to talk about that. It's not one person. It's not just Julie. It's not just me. We have to talk about that collectively and figure out what is the benefit for the town. It's not a benefit to Julie. It's not a benefit to me. It's not a, what is the benefit to our community? But I think there's always an opportunity in everything. And we have to really look very closely at that. And we do have to work more closely together and to hear from you and to, I don't, as much as I love Carter's weekly reports, raise your hand if you're a department head, and I talk to you all the time. Thank you. Because I need that kind of feedback. That's how I process things. I don't tell you what to do. I don't tell you how to do your job. But I can't just see it on a piece of paper. How does that work for you? What does that mean for you? There's a lot of nuances when people speak so that, you know, I can hear what you have to say. We're in a tough spot, and we've been in a tough spot. But I think that we have a great challenge to do what's the best for our community. And Ron, I hear some of the same things. I'd be more than happy to pay more taxes, not to lose service. I think that we should think more outside of the box. I've talked to Diana about this. Let's do some fundraising. Let's do some, you know, y'all might be tired of hearing that, but it's the truth. We have to own some of this stuff, period. And those are just my thoughts on that.
Thanks for your point, Ron. That's great. Thanks, Diane. Yes, go ahead.
If I may, on the...
Are we talking finance again?
Audit? Question on the audit? Did I understand that we've changed audit firms? And if so, was it my understanding that the one that was almost complete, or they had been working on, we've changed even that year to a new audit firm? Is that correct? And if so, what is the reason for that? It feels like if we had someone, we would be much further along than starting over with somebody new. So I'm just trying to understand that.
Do you want to answer that, Mr.
Pender? If you'd like, sure. You retained Clifton Larson and Allen, I believe, to carry out an audit of FY13 only, at a cost of $28,000. I discussed with them, when I first got here, I was told that they had been engaged for 14 and 15 as well. So I asked for the engagement letter and reviewed it, and it turned out that, in fact, you had not engaged them for 14 and 15. Their schedule called for them to be here in January, and they were unwilling to discuss completing 14 and 15 until they had been deeper into 13. Also, we came to learn that their fee for 14 and 15 would approach $45,000 per year, not the discounted rate of $28,000 per year that they had given you for FY13. In my view, that left the town very much behind the eight ball. We'd have to complete 13, then go find someone to tackle 14, 15, 16, and 17 within the $28,000 per year that you had budgeted. Therefore, I approached the select board and asked for permission to approach other audit firms. The first firm that we contacted was unwilling to consider doing business with you. The second firm was unwilling to consider doing business with you if I were to leave, and I am leaving. The next firm that we spoke with had previously done your work, and we thought that there was some, public relations issues, even though I know them, I've worked with them for a number of years, and they're a very quality firm. And the fourth firm was actually recommended to us by the Department of Revenue. They do the Phillipston, town of Phillipston, if I remember correctly, but they certainly do the Narragansett Regional School District. They do Princeton. They have recently cleaned up the books for Winchendon. They instruct on bond issues for DOR, and they come highly recommended. They were prepared to do the 5 years, 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17, hopefully rolling from 1 year into the next so that we are completed with 16 by the end of this fiscal year. And all good luck, we hope for, perhaps even have fiscal 17 completed by this time next year. And you would always hope to have 1 year's completed by the time you're starting your budget for your next year. They're willing to do that within the $28,000 per year that we allotted. And they are starting on Monday.
The 12th.
That is the schedule. Allen's and his folks have been diligently preparing workspace for them down in the basement. All things being equal, I think the town is substantially ahead, even after writing off the $13,000 you're already paid CLA, to get a very reputable firm to do all 5 years earlier than CLA was willing to do, and at a substantially reduced rate.
Wow. Go ahead.
My follow-up question is, each of these audits is going to cost $28,000, and we hope to have up to 15 anyway done by the end of this fiscal year.
Oh no, I'm hoping to be through 16 by the end of this fiscal year.
But we've only budgeted $28,000
per year. Audits. That's right.
No, in our budget for this year, we've only budgeted $28,000.
And you budgeted $28,000 in prior years. And my understanding from the accountant is that those monies were encumbered and carried forward. I'm not sure it's the way I do it, but that is the way that you've done it here. And I stand to be corrected, you know, send me the, your concern or your query, and I'll confirm it or get you a straighter answer.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, Carter. Yes.
And the second thing, you mentioned it earlier about, and we talked a little bit about consolidation or restructuring, I think was the word you used. Clearly, bringing it up means that there's talk and thought of that from the selectmen. I'm just wondering what goals and what you guys see, you know, do you have a plan A, plan B, plan C, or what are you looking for people here to be saying right now, hey, we recommend this, this, or this?
There are a few plans, yes. What they are all together, some I can talk about. I might have to leave the room, but there's plans of consolidation of or merging of the department heads.
Not only to save dollars for the gap, but obviously looking forward in the future. Is it the right way to do business? Like not hiring a fire chief? I mean, is it not doing this? Is it not doing that? And we're looking at all aspects of this, not just the cost savings as far as the individual himself or herself, as far as a salary, but people don't understand the other stuff that goes attached with that, like your health benefits because you're full-time, or the Worcester State Retirement System, and all that stuff adds up. So when you actually hire somebody for, say, you know, I'll use numbers, say $50,000 a year, you know, you don't pay $50,000 a year. You're paying $75,000 a year because you're paying benefits on top of that. So when you budget stuff like that, you have to budget that stuff in. So when we looked at, I say we, collectively, with Mr. Tanzini, when he presents that stuff to us, like, okay, this is where all the money savings is, not just because of the salary, but because of all the other stuff that attaches to that individual that's employed, which also includes our unemployment. Our unemployment will go down as well, unemployability payment that we have to pay. So, I mean, it hits everything across the board.
So are you asking this form, as you mentioned earlier, ideas of the committees for how to restructure? Is that what you were looking for? How we're doing, but our ideas as to how things could work better?
I mean, if you want to send some of those ideas in to Mr. Tanzini, I'm sure he's more than happy to collect those and put them out to the Board of Selectmen, and obviously then brief us on them. I think we're going down.
Yeah.
We're going down. Submarine down. I think we do have a plan A and a plan B, and hopefully a contingency plan moving forward. And what we're looking at is not just a temporary band-aid fix. We are looking for cutthroat fix that we need to, you know, we need to really consolidate, condense, and move forward. And then save. I mean, and then with plans and policies in place for other stuff, such as, you know, a free cash policy that, you know, that goes into stabilization, or that goes into emergency and capital planning and different percentages. You know, working with other departments that have increasing revenues, like the ambulance department, the town ambulance, increasing their rates, which we did last week, which again, you're talking rates that they were using probably from 20 years ago. It was horrifying. I mean, so all that stuff adds up. The fact that the building department rates, when building contractors come into this town to get a permit, they kind of chuckle on the way out the door. Because, I mean, by square footage, I mean, we're probably one of the lowest places in town around as far as to build. So, everything is being looked at, everything. I mean, and every stone is being overturned, and every closet door is being opened, and, you know, we're coming up with some good ideas. I mean, a 1% food tax, potentially. I like to see that down the road. Well, what does that do? That brings about $42,000 to $50,000 per year in. I mean, it's little stuff.
Are you going to tax my food?
No, not your food. Your different food. But you know what I'm saying? I mean, you have to look at everything, and it might not pass, but you know what? You have to at least give the people the option to say, hey, this is where we are, and this is how we get from plan A, or this is how we get from A to B. And if you don't like it, then you say no. As people, this has been going on since the 1700s, you know, in a room like this, you know.
You know, so we're talking about different ideas, and one of the things that came up early was, where's the school? Why is it not here yet? We could look at doing some fundraising. Other towns use that for certain projects besides just borrowing money. And there's a lot of people in town that I think would be more than willing to say, yeah, I want this school, and help out in different ways to help raise money for getting this off the ground. That seems to be what's holding us up right now, is getting the money. We've got the approvals, the townspeople are behind it. So now maybe we need to go that next step and say, well, if the town's having trouble getting that loan, maybe we can do something to help offset that.
And just to answer your question too, just so you understand, I mean, you can't honor into a contract without having secured funds to back that contract.
Right.
That's what delays the process. Yeah, you could go fundraising. I like the GoFundMe sites. That thing's great. I had a veteran that was in a bad car accident here in town, and working dad, three kids. You know, I helped him with a GoFundMe site to help out the family. I said, you know, the stuff that you can do like that. I mean, I don't think baking cookies, doing that type of stuff is really the the way you want to go for a large-scale project like this, but I think a GoFundMe site with the big thermometer thing in the center of town that has like the lines in it, something like that. Absolutely, I think, you know, these are great ideas, and these are what needs to come forward. But we're moving forward, we're getting closer, it's just that, we're getting it. Just be patient, and the taxpayers be patient, because we have a way, we just gotta, we're getting there. Does that answer your question?
Oh, it answers my question.
Okay, anything else? Not budget though, please.
I'd like to say thank you to Mr. Moore, is that your name? For saying that the town is behind the school, because a lot of people don't think that the town is. And the MSBA questions whether the town really wants the school. So I think it's important that we're positive toward it and that we do things for it. So thank you for saying that.
Well, I know I took a lot of flack at the last town meeting.
No.
Because, you know, I wanted to get out to townspeople the concern that, you know, we were having trouble getting the money. And they needed to know that. And without getting that motion to the floor, we didn't really get that open discussion. The townspeople need to be aware that, you know, that we have issues. It doesn't mean just because we look at something and say, hey, we don't see how to afford this, that doesn't mean we don't want it. And I think there's a lot of people in town that are saying, we want this, we believe we need a new school. There might be disagreements about how that school is, but everyone says we need a new school. And it's really about the finances. And I think that, you know, this could give some positive energy for the townspeople to say, you know, we can raise some money while the town administrators work on dealing with their thing. Give the townspeople something positive that they can be doing to help out in town. When you give a project to a community, it brings people together.
Exactly. Also, just so you know, when you, just to elaborate, just one more thing and I'm done, is the fact that when you talk about increasing the tax rate, the town doesn't have the authority to do that. The Department of Revenue does. So when the recap sheet goes to the Department of Revenue, they come back to us and tell us what the tax rate is. We don't tell them, they tell us based on things that are happening here in town. House prices are going up, you know, different revenue landmarks and checkpoints that they're working on. So they tell us. In fact, you know what the tax rate is right now? Everybody know what the tax rate is?
What's it going to be, or what
it is right now? No, it's not what it is.
1642?
It is 1612 right now. It is $16.12. It actually went down over 30 cents.
How does that compare with similar communities in the county?
Well, it compares based on, you really can't compare because it's based on the housing market in Templeton and the house prices in Templeton went up.
Let me ask a question differently.
Yeah, sure.
The amount of tax dollars we pay for an average house, how does that compare with other towns? Not the rate, because I know the rates can be skewed depending on a lot of things.
Yeah.
If you pay $2,500 tax in your house, that same house in Barry, what are they paying? What are they paying in Apple? What are they paying in Garden?
That's more of a real estate related
really
question.
Sure,
that's
honest,
not a.
Jim, I'm not
sure. You know, you put a house here.
Let me into that one,
and you put that in Concord. I mean, that's not really how it is. I believe that.
The reason I pose a question to
Apples.
That's not comparing apples to apples.
No offense, Dave. I'm not trying to be smart. But in my opinion, a lot of people are not going to agree with me.
Yep.
I know Beverly won't. The taxes in Templeton have been so low for so long.
Yep.
I don't see us getting out of this hole ever because you can't raise the taxes to where they should be.
Well,
and
you're right.
That would hurt a lot of people who can't afford it. But that's the way it is.
We
it
have
is what it is.
You're right, and we're working that issue because again, what some of the stuff that will be going on the tax rate, such as you know the police station, such as the new school eventually. You know, that can't go on until next year because once the rate is locked, Mr. Tenzini, correct me if I'm wrong, once the rate is locked, it's locked until next year. So
you
we
can't raise it over 2.5 anyway unless you get a vote. That's not happening.
No, but if we had voted tax exclusions, tax additions, it will debt exclusions those can go on, and if they do vote 2.5, then that's just how it is.
I
don't
want to pay any more taxes than the next
No, me neither.
Take a look around.
I know. I'm with you. Mr. Tenzini.
In reality, Tom, you're two different people. You are the tax person says, I don't want my taxes to go up. But the town person who works in these committees and is a member of town, oh yeah, we need these things. I don't mind paying extra. Exactly, that's how I feel.
And the people, generally speaking, I feel like they're getting nothing for their taxes.
That's correct.
And you talked about support for the school. There is a lot of resentment in this town because people feel the school budget gets handled first and the town gets what's left. And that's the way it works. There's a lot of resentment about that.
Well, I understand that. Yeah, John.
This old data, at least a year old, but last year, Templeton had the ninth lowest tax rate out of the 351 cities.
Ninth lowest.
There you go. And as far as the school budget goes, I'm sure Mrs. Kozo can tell you, that's dictated to us.
I'm just saying what the perception is. The perception is reality. Sorry to say.
Yeah. It is. I hear that in service all the time.
But you know, the thing is, no, for years and years, we've had two lower taxes. That's
what
I'm saying.
That's what I put up with.
Yeah, right, Tom. Yeah, Mr. Tanzini.
Well, first, let me say that, you know, unfortunately, for better or worse in Massachusetts, the schools fall under our total tax cap. It's not the way in all states, but that is the way it is here. And if you can imagine this, my wife is a special education director. And so that leads to a number of very interesting conversations around our table of how much the schools need to support everything that they do and how evil the town administrators slash managers are as we try to jawbone them to see if they won't take less out of the total tax cap. Secondly, certainly we'll take those comparative towns that we have and give you some percentages and show you. I look at the average single family tax bill in comparison to the median family income, and you do have one of the lower rates around. However, that's got nothing to do with nothing in terms of convincing your community to do whatever you think they need to do. And folks, I get to say this because I'm only here for a few months, but even if I was here for longer, I generally tend to say whatever it is that I think I need to say. Until you get a set of books that people can rely upon, and you can keep that set of books current and well known, and you can show people that you are squeezing every nickel out that you can, you're going to have a tough row of it. And until you sustainably fund the proper amount of financial and administrative staff, and you're right about where you should be now, and you pay them at appropriate rates so you can attract and keep good, competent people, not just fill slots, you will have a tough row of it. And I can only tell you from my experience in Spencer, which is a poorer community than you, and had a similar history of turning everything down. We passed three overrides after I got there, and we passed 7 out of 9 requests for debt exclusions and capital exclusions because we were able to show people that the very tough decisions were being made. And I don't necessarily mean just cutting staff or cutting hours. I mean, they really went through some pain down there. Folks will vote for it. And working together, communicating, if there's an idea of something, send it to us. I'm here 4 days a week. I may not get back to you as quickly as you like. We'll monetize it. We'll send it along the select board. But I know that working together, you can get there over a period of years.
Great. Okay, anything else you want to talk about?
Sorry, you know me, I talk too much. I want to know why we don't have a fully a quorum for a capital planning committee. I'm tired of asking that. We have a planning board member who hasn't showed up in I don't know how long on the research that I did, so I don't know if there's another person who can be appointed. I don't know who it is. I've had a rough couple of weeks. Somebody from the school committee is supposed to be on capital planning. I don't know if they come. But we have to make some...
We did get that nomination.
Okay, fine. So we need to have, it's a very important committee, and we can't continue to not have a quorum because they can't even make recommendations to anyone else. So we need a capital planning committee.
Can that be solved by having a change of rules in the town, saying if you don't show up for X amount of meetings, you're off, and somebody else is appointed? And the committee can appoint somebody for that year.
By law.
And fills a position.
We don't have that this year. We have to change it at the annual meeting.
No, yeah, but we can do that at the annual meeting.
Well, right now, there are spots. The people have to come.
We've had that problem forever.
Yeah.
We have a school committee member who hasn't shown up in 2 years.
Yeah, I know.
But he's an elected official, so we can do nothing.
Right.
Every committee has the same thing.
Wow. Go ahead, John.
On the capital planning committee, is the membership determined by local bylaw?
I believe it is.
I believe it is, yeah. We have to take a look at the bylaw.
Yes.
Open up some other positions.
Right.
So it's a little bit cheaper for them.
Yeah, I think you're right. That might be something that we need to...
This is just a general, just somebody doesn't show up for 5 meetings, boom, they're off. And the committee itself can appoint somebody, and that fills it for the year, and now you take care of the quorum.
Isn't that the way the advisory board is?
It is.
Yes.
Works wonderful, doesn't it?
In the past, we've had to invoke that, and we actually gave the individual the chance to either resign or end up having to invoke.
So if you can't, you know, why can't some of the other committees?
Pardon me?
All right, anything else? Chief, we haven't heard from you. How's things going over there?
Day to day.
Day to day?
Cough and stuff.
Day to day. Quickly, I would have to apologize to people here about the station project not being what it was sold as. Apparently, me being new to everything, I thought that I had the plan and I was crossing all my T's and crossing my I's, and then when the debt exclusion came up and passed, apparently it was written wrong. The debt exclusion approves the funding for the station but does not do a 2-year debt exclusion. So unfortunately, with Carter's assistance, we've reached out to USDA for a loan to fund the project, and that's where we're at on the station.
We work special legislation on that to the State House, or do we have to do a revote?
We're still working through that. But...
Okay, thanks, Chief. Keep doing what you're doing. Yes.
Yes, I was having a word with one of the selectmen in Phillipston yesterday, and he mentioned that it had been proposed that you share a fire chief. And this person said he was hesitant to approve such a thing because in years past, we're talking quite a while now, but at one time when it came to funding the schools, Phillipston was paying more than its fair share, while Templeton was paying well under. And we know that. That's a fact.
Yeah.
And so his concern was that if they went into a regional agreement for a fire chief, that they might, if you pardon the expression, get shafted on the financial end of the agreement.
Well, there's no secret. Yeah, that we looked at every option available to us. So did we speak with Phillipson? Yep. Did we speak with Winchenden? Yes. Did we go to Hubbardston? Yes. We looked at all our options to present to the Board of Selectmen so they can make a rational, educated decision on what's the best avenue of approach to sustain the town going forward. Because that's where we're at right now. We're looking at every avenue that we can. I mean, that's just, when Mr. Tanzini briefs the Board of Selectmen, he's just not briefing us because he just thinks he knows what he's taught. He's actually talked to these people. He met with the Board of Selectmen or the town manager or the TA at in Hubbardston, and they talked about it. It's communicated. I mean, is it what we're going to decide? Probably. It's one of the choices. But
so you have several options.
Mm-hmm.
obviously it has to be reciprocal agreement, but the options are all still open.
Right, and we knew with Phillips specifically, because you're looking at 1,400 people versus 8,000 people, that just like the school, who, you know, we do, I know they were paying a high share, I understand that. But we will always pay more because we have more people. So even if we did do a joint chief situation for our fire, we know that we would still take the burden of the most amount of money. And we're looking at that, like, does that still benefit the community? Number one, have a regionalized chief that's here a couple hours a day, a couple days a week, and we're still paying more than the other time. We're looking at all those options. Nothing is being left off the table for all of the selectmen to have a copy of so they can make a rational, educated decision. But,
then
yes?
I have a second question.
Okay.
Perhaps Carter could address this. Bernie, he and myself, last fiscal year 15, we spent some time in the basement of the town hall, and we had boxes of papers from fiscal year 13 and fiscal year 14. And fiscal year 13, you know, they were literally, they were marked fiscal year 13, 14, so it wasn't as if the 2 years had been clumped together. But the papers were not in any particular order, and we sent several hours, the purpose being to help our accountant, Kelly, so that she could, well, at that point, I think we were saying reconstruct, but I think you used the word construct, the books for fiscal year 13 and 14. And my understanding was that when the audit firm, the original audit firm, came in, that they found that fiscal year 13, there were so many documents missing. And I remember at the time, you know, I worked on 14 and Bernie worked on 13. And it did seem there was the difference, you'd have thought you'd have approximately the same number of documentation. And I had a lot more than he had. So I thought, gosh, I'm working harder than he is. But what I realized is he was missing documentation. And I'm just wondering if that documentation has either been found or did they go to the department heads who would have been able to give their copies of, for example, a purchase order or, for example, payroll, whatever it might have been. Have they been able to reconstruct fiscal year 13? Will the auditors be able to deal with the documentation that's available, and will they be able to carry through with the audit as necessary?
Yes, Mr. Tenzini, go ahead. The answer is yes.
The answer is yes. The books have been reconstructed sufficient to carry out the audit. Certainly, as we get closer, 13, 14, 15, 16, we'll be tightening up the audit standards each step of the way. And we're going to have to work with the condition of the books that they're in. But I think that by the end of the day, you'll have a good picture of where you stand.
Okay, so you've been able to.
That's my understanding.
That's good.
That's okay, so my understanding.
Not to kick it, you know, an animal here, but is there anything else? I mean, we're talking about communication, we're talking about structure, we're talking about the town, we're talking about we all do something good for the town. We all give something to everybody. What do you guys think? Do you guys have specific questions for us, or do you have things or goals that you guys have? Or, I know you guys are working with some other issues. This is just for us to get together. I think we should probably, I'd like to see this at least maybe once a year, just to say hi, see what's going on, see how you guys are doing, see how we're doing. School committee, I'd like to meet with you more than once, but just to say hi. But again, we all need to work together. And I can't say it enough.
I'd like to go along with Diane. The only thing I'd like to join is keep the public informed of what's going on.
You're right. I agree.
And we always encourage them to come to our every other Monday evening selectmen meetings.
Yes.
Not only when it's important to them, only one issue, but maybe just come would be nice. There's some nights we have 3 or 4, there's some nights we have 50.
I honestly don't know.
You know, so, you know, trying to rally the troops to come in would be great.
Yep. Yes, I know. And you guys make really great decisions over there for the health and education of our children, so it's very important. We all have important jobs, you know, from the chief of police to the finance committee or advisory committee to health, to council on aging, highway.
Well, what you guys do, you're not getting any pay. I got to really compliment all of you, all of you.
Well, we do it because we like it. Anybody else have anything else to add?
Everybody in the room too, but I...
Yep, go ahead.
Planning board has just, with the help of MRPC, just completed the town's master plan. And we're going to be going through a review phase over the next couple of months. But I would encourage, you know, all town members, board members and stuff, to attend at least one of those review sessions, so.
Great.
That is great. That's a
real... Does anybody know what that is?
That's huge.
What a master plan is? I mean, this took, what, 5 years?
Well, it's taken at least 5. I think it's closer to 5 than that. Probably
I think it's
closer to 10.
Well, we
had to do it in stages because
of funding.
Because of funding.
I got you. But that 5-year plan is going to be huge for our development and growth down the road.
Well, it's something the town hasn't had for decades, though.
Right.
That would make a really great public program.
Yep.
Mr. Castle.
We're on it.
You can utilize Scott Hall while you do it.
I'm just saying, like, that is a very important document, and it's taken a long time to complete, and it's needed. So in order to, in this forum, it's kind of hard to explain all of that, but that would be great.
Carl's been in touch with us on all the hearings.
Thank you.
So now you have hearings coming up on the 13th. I think that's MRPC, right?
Right, and just the bid process being scheduled.
I think Glenn Eaton mentioned at our Economic Development Committee about the master plan hearing in January.
In January.
Yeah. We're all over it.
Great. Anything else to add before we adjourn? Nothing? Well,
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Thank you. Merry Christmas, everybody. I want to thank everybody for coming. It means a lot to me because obviously we all do work for the same, which is the people of Templeton. So we have to bring us together somehow. We might not agree, but we can agree to disagree and then drink a beer when we're done and move on from there and hopefully get the job done for the people here that live here, like all of us. Okay? Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Yeah.
A second? That's excellent. All in favor? Aye. Thanks, everybody. Merry Christmas, everybody.
Yeah, I got spoiled. It's got to be.